now.
All right. It says we're live streaming, so we're live.
It says it's setting up online.
I mean, I'm still not seeing it, so, you know, again.
We've done that before, so I'm pretty sure we're live.
Gentrification is live now.
Okay.
Yeah. I see it. So this is Press Play Northwest. I'm Bruce Poinsette.
And I'm Donovan Smith.
And I'm Molly Mitchell.
Yeah, and you're tuned into the destination, or your destination for deep dives into Northwest hip hop's most provocative visuals. And we got a special guest tonight, Swiggle Mandela, who we're going to bring out a little bit later. But first, let's just talk a little bit about, you know, what this platform is. Back in, I want to say April, you know, three of us decided we wanted to, you know, dig into, you know, just some of the great videos coming out of the scene. And, you know, try it on like a new platform. We all got, you know, locked in with quarantine and everything. So, you know, it gave us the opportunity to try out this thing on Zoom, have a little, you know, facilitated discussions. Like I said, dig into the video, talk with, you know, some of the best artists in the scene right now. And, you know, we're going on episode. None of us have been counting. It doesn't matter. But it was starting this spring and we're here now. So, yeah. Yeah, we didn't plan out any of this intro.
Tonight, I think tonight is going to be like a very, you know, I'm looking forward to talking with Swiggle. We've shown his video, a couple of his videos on this show in the past, 40 Acres in a New Car. We had like a pretty rich discussion around that. When we had Max Smith on along with Akuna for our last episode, you know, to honor We Out Here magazine, you know, the video that Mac chose as like one of the preeminent videos that's come out of the scene was Dear Portland Police. So I know we'll be showing it again tonight with Swiggle on the show, but I think it'll be, you know, a chance to really dive deep with him as the artist who put this together. And there's been so many different iterations of the song, and, you know, even with what happened tonight with the, you know, ruling around Breonna Taylor, it just like is like a very, you know, like it's a very unfortunately timely discussion we'll be having with him. Not that it hasn't been this whole time, you know, especially with Portland being super, you know, the streets have been very active out here. And Swiggle's also been a part of that as a performer. But also his video with Lit Tonight with Raz. I think there's a lot to discuss with that just because, you know, Raz being one of the biggest artists to come out of Seattle, Swiggle being one of the biggest artists to come out of Portland, and those two coming together for a song on his debut album. I think there's a lot to discuss around that video as well. So I'm looking forward to it.
Yeah. So with that, if you'd like to, kind of felt like an introduction to our guest, but I'd like to, you know, give official welcome Swiggle in.
Doing a little clicking around, bringing them in. There we go.
What up?
Welcome to Swiggle. Welcome. Thank you for being here tonight.
Of course. Thank you for having me.
Yeah. So, yeah, just as a little bit of a background on Swiggle, you know, he's, I don't know if we could really call you a Portland native. I mean, you definitely represent Portland, but Portland, Cali, Estacada even. These are all parts of your background and everything. Artist that represents his label La Familia Gang, which has been a staple here in the city for quite some time. And yeah, business owner, somebody who been in various industries, clothing, storefronts, you know, and you might even catch him slinging burgers here and there at different businesses throughout the city. So very, what's the word? Industrious is not the word I was looking for, but yeah, somebody who knows how to multiply their different hustles and is a good or great MC as well. And just put out his first album, which it doesn't even feel like it should be your first, but last year, Portlandsterdam, a 29 track album that I have described this album to people in the past, just kind of as like a love letter to Portland. So that's what it feels like to me. I think with the two songs that we're going to get into tonight with Dear Portland Police and Lit Tonight, they represent kind of two core sides of you as an artist. You know, there's definitely this very socially aware side that you speak to, and also having a little bit of party music too to balance it out. So, looking forward to getting into to both tonight. So yeah, thank you for being here again.
For sure, man. Thank you for that introduction and, you know, recognizing my work. I really appreciate it.
Absolutely. Yeah, so we're just going to get into it with Press, or this is Press Play Northwest Radio, and I'm so used to saying radio. This is Press Play Northwest Live, and we're going to screen Dear Portland Police first.
Swiggle, Dear Portland Police. I know all cops ain't bad, but we talking to you though. Dear Portland Police, I just want my peace. They done freed Lil Swag, he back on the streets. They traded in they sheets, they traded in they sheets. We don't fuck with Portland, you don't want the beef. Dear Portland Police, I just want my peace. They done freed Lil Swag, he back on the streets. They traded in they sheets, they traded in they sheets. Yeah, we don't fuck with Portland, you don't want the beef. Dear Portland Police, what's your name, man? And was your dad's dad a wizard of the KKK? You ain't gotta lie, let's keep it the bean. I don't fuck with pork, I've been on my dean. SubhanAllah, got him screaming Emmett Till his back. Better handcuff your daughters, I'm the fucking Mac. Then peck a wood shot, sneak G, but the monster live. Rest in peace, Pat Kendra, James, your heart for rest. Yeah, dear Portland Police, I just want my peace. So give me my peace, no, we run the streets. They traded in they sheets, they traded in they sheets. We don't fuck with Portland, you don't want the beef. Dear Portland Police, dear NYPD, dear LAPD, no, we run the streets. They traded in they sheets, they traded in they sheets. We don't fuck with pork, you don't want the beef.
Welcome to me jungle where them boys swim. Be ready for them war with them damn police. Be ready for them problems. Be screaming for me shatter.
Dear Portland Police, dear NYPD, dear LAPD, no, we run the streets. They traded in they sheets, they traded in they sheets. We don't fuck with pork, yo.
Gang pass on that gangster shit. Politics of that banging shit. Protesting all of that racist shit. They looting, burning, and flaming shit. My niggas fed up, no taming this. Break the chains on that slavery shit. Been black as fuck, and they hate the shit. I died for this to my grave and shit. Young black and unconscious mind. Black wealth on a monster grind. They persecute, oppress a nigga. Lock us up and give us time. The heartbeat of a real nigga. We been about them fields, nigga. Be careful on them traffic stops. They gun you down and kill niggas. Equal rights and equality.
failed rights and them policies. They buck rides that jail time. Niggas can't make up for that lost time. The system been on our back, nigga. It's way more than that rap, nigga. I'm stressed as fuck from being black, nigga. So this is how we act, nigga. Kids doing dumb shit. Yep. Only red, white, and blue that we had in our life came with sirens and cannons at night.
That's true.
Also had color black in the back of the vehicle. Hope that they're back in our life.
Lord,
cause when
please.
Sons go away and the daughters get made into prisoners' state, you don't know if this might be the night that they go losing life. What a sight to see. Right comes far as the eye can see. Body armor black, like they're trapped in the bodies they have trapped, breaking every single life they seize.
Yep.
Slaves of imperialist dynasty. Seems like the only thing they want to bleed. The flesh from the rest of the chest, which described tone ain't quite the same as the sight of me.
Police.
Yeah, that was Dear Portland Police. So I think, you know, obviously, you know, today has been a difficult day for a lot of people with, you know, the Breonna Taylor decision to, you know, was it charge one cop with wanton endangerment, not even for shooting Breonna, but for shooting into another apartment. So I think obviously that being on a lot of people's mind, it's one of the first questions to ask is, you know, if you had any thoughts on, you know, the decision that went down today.
I mean, of course it doesn't, it's not justice. It's extremely unfortunate. It's also unfortunate that it's not a big surprise. You know, we hope for the best, but you know, when you're dealing with a corrupt system, and you know, from the highest to the lowest people in it, it's, you know, you kind of expect these kind of things. And you know, we always hope for the best, but it's heartbreaking. And I feel for her family and our people in general.
Yeah, and like you said, unfortunately, this isn't a surprising decision. I mean, we saw yesterday they were putting out a state of emergency out there in Louisville before the decision was even made. So, I mean, that was kind of like them telling us exactly what was coming. And we didn't need, you know what I mean? But yeah, here in town, you know, there's been these protests that have been going for 100+ days. And the only break that happened was just because, you know, the smoke, the fires that have been happening out here. You know, you haven't been taken to the streets per se, but you have been stepping out into the protests, you know, with your music. What has been your motivation out there as you're performing?
Well, honestly, I just felt like it's my place to be there. Just being who I am, a Black and Filipino man in Portland, Oregon, you know, United States of America, it just feels like, you know, I was supposed to be there. 'Cause, you know, you look at the civil rights movement, you look at even further back than that, you know, people escaping slavery. And our ancestors have been fighting this fight for, you know, for hundreds and thousands of years. And so, I mean, like all my life, I've been waiting almost to fight the fight. And of course, throughout my life, I've been to protests. I've always recorded the same kind of music. But of course, recently this year, it definitely came to like an exploding point, and it just felt like destiny. Like, you know, my mom named me Mandela. So from everything I've been taught and everything I've been through, it was just like where I was supposed to be. And, you know, I can't always be out on the front line. It's just not my place. And honestly, I have super bad asthma, and it's like just with the tear gas and what those protesters endure, and shout out to them. You know, I got friends that be on the front line, and that's a huge thing. But for me, it's just not my place. So it feels good to be able to have my music be sort of like a soundtrack to the protests. And the opportunities that I had to perform at protests have been some of the most groundbreaking, electrifying performances in my career. So yeah, it just felt like, you know, it's almost like I owe my ancestors as much as I owe, you know, my kids and the future of this world. So it's almost like an obligation, but it's just a part of my heritage to fight.
Absolutely. And just kind of thinking about, again, what you're saying with the lack of surprise, like in this song in particular, like Dear Portland Police, you know, recorded this years ago.
Yeah.
And so you're already speaking to what's been the environment, the impressive environment with police here in the city before that. And I know your little brother, he's been a victim of police violence where they had tased him as a teenager. You know, so you've revisited this song, I believe, three times, recorded different versions of it. So why has this song meant so much to you in terms of like re-recording
yeah.
and the iterations?
Well, I think part of being an independent artist, and I don't know what it's like to be an artist who is an independent. I've always been independent. So part of just being in charge of my own career, what I enjoy is just not letting my songs get old. You know, like my songs don't have an expiration date. And just kind of giving my songs their full life cycle that they can have, and almost thinking about my songs like a living being. You know, I want to give that, I want to water it, I want to give it a bright future, I want it to have everything that it's supposed to have. So when I did Dear Portland Police, I always kind of thought that just me doing it wasn't enough. Like, I have my perspective, but there's so many different points of view when it comes to police brutality and the injustice of that system. And so originally I put the song out as a challenge, like anybody could rap on the beat. That's still the situation. Like, people can go and find the beat on YouTube and just rap on it if they want, record, or just, you know, make a video with their phone. But that's, you know, because I usually charge people to do a song because it's my bread and butter. This is how I make a living. But with Dear Portland Police, I just felt that, you know, it's a song about injustice. It's a song about standing up for the power that the people have. And I just wanted to kind of just gift that to the community, to the world, whoever wants to make music on that. And shout out to Jay Hicks for making the beat. But, and so there's so many versions. In this moment right now, I'm not even sure if I can think of all of them, but there's a bunch of people who did the Dear Portland Police challenge, recorded it, put it out. So it's on like SoundCloud and Spotify and everywhere else. But then, you know, after the execution of George Floyd and the explosive historical protest that started to happen here, more and more people at the protests were contacting me and telling me like, yo, you should be here, you should perform here. This is where you fit in here. This is what you've been talking about. And so I actually rewrote Dear Portland Police again, more current, and, you know, went to a protest and performed it. And that was kind of like the rebirth of it, of 2020. And, you know, we just wanted to make it as big as possible and just almost like a bonfire. You know, everybody's just throwing in wood and contributing what they can. And that's when my older brother decided, my older brother JC Cordetta decided that we should put Cool Nuts on it. And so Cool Nuts is like the newest part of Dear Portland Police. The version with Micah Fletcher, shout out to Micah, already existed. The version with my brother and my Haitian brother Anael already existed. And then we mixed two of them together, the one with Anael and JC and the one with Micah. We put them together and then we added Cool Nuts. So it was like a science project of just putting everything together.
It's real multi-generational that way too. And, you know, as much as this is absolutely about Black lives, I think one of the things with Micah being in that video, that, you know, one of the most infamous things that's happened in this city was the, you know, what happened on the Max stabbings, and Micah being the person who stood, one of the people who stood up, and then, you know, being stabbed and, you know, surviving that incident. One of the things that I think about with Dear Portland Police is, like, obviously the man who did that, you know, he was able to, like, finish a beer while the police were approaching him. But also the day before, Demetria Hester had encountered the same man, a Black woman, on the mats, had problems with him, and the whole city was walking past her as on a Max platform and nobody did anything. She pepper sprayed him, and the police literally, you know, he was right there washing his eyes out, and she was like, that's the person who attacked me. And they say, oh, we said he didn't do it. You know, like, just the amount of protection that did not come, that allowed that moment to happen the next day with Micah and all those other people, you know, and obviously that man was harassing two young Black girls as well during that moment. You know, it's just a lot to speak to in terms, again, like the environment of policing that we are currently under, because that was 2017, you know, that was 2017 that happened. And I know Mike is a mentee of yours as well.
Yeah, that's why I thought it was important to have Micah on the song to begin with. You know, even before we decided to shoot the video, like, you know, 2018. And when we decided to shoot the video, because, you know, it's needed right now, just the environment. I knew that I wanted to put Micah on it, even though the songs were separate. I wanted to figure out a way to put the songs together just so that story can keep being told. And it's hard for Micah, you know, because he was there. It's a tragic situation he had to experience and thank God survive and live through. And so it's hard for him to keep telling that story. But I feel like people like us know the story. And when he's on the song and it's such a big project, it starts that conversation. And so I thought that was important, and to show that, you know, we do have people in this city who will stand up, and there is unity. We're coming together. And, you know, there's a scene where Micah is standing, he has his bandana on, and there's the painting behind him of the woman in the hijab with only her eyes showing the painting. And that was kind of like just relating to the situation of the Max stabbing and him, you know, standing up for those young girls. And, you know, I remember me and Micah doing shows and Micah giving a speech at the show, like, yo, y'all need to listen up and make sure that we're getting this message out, because what happened to me is not gonna be the last situation. And, you know, we're just doing concerts. We're just doing, you know, parties and being artists. But we always had to touch on that. And yeah, I'm glad that he was on the project, and I feel like it made it so much more powerful.
For sure. And just for anybody who doesn't know, Micah Fletcher is Cool Chief Rocker as his artist name. So yeah, Micah Fletcher.
Hey, so you're talking earlier, like, about really like incorporating history, like, into like the way, both into like the messaging, the music, and like one of the things the three of us really want to talk about is kind of like the imagery in Dear Portland Police. And I think one of the things that stood out to me was just like the Haitian flag, you know, so like little machetes around that. But for those who aren't kind of like familiar sort of with the history of Haiti, can you talk about why it's so important to include that in the video?
Well, for one, my boy Anael Janis, who's featured on the song, is full-blooded Haitian. And so we definitely wanted to represent his culture in the video. And then also Haiti being a country of Black people that liberated themselves. And you know, the machete is very symbolic of that liberation. And you know, it's a violent, I would kind of maybe say unfortunate, but you know, they definitely took their freedom, and we want to embody that spirit of like, I just have a lot of respect for the Haitian people and their culture and what they represent. And you know, that being a Black country, you know, of free people, and you know, they don't show you everything on the in the media of what Haiti really is. They show you a lot of the poverty, which there is, and they need help, and we always want to do that. But at the same time, it's a beautiful country. It's a beautiful people. And you know, I was hearing recently, we had a conversation, me and some of my Haitian family, talking about how when Haiti, when they liberated themselves, it was you know, there was talk amongst other countries who were still involved in the slave trade, and they were very worried about, you know, that story, that narrative getting out, that there's these people who liberated themselves and overthrew their oppressors. And so just the power of that story and the love I have for all my Haitians, man, and Sok Passe to all my Haitians. A lot of people don't know the Haitian community here in Portland. It's not a huge one, but it's a strong one. And there are a lot of Haitians, you know what I'm saying? And I know a lot of Haitians. I grew up going to Haitian parties and performing with Haitian bands. And, you know, my best friend Anael, who's on the song, is Haitian. And so, yeah, that was important that we show that, you know, especially like, it was almost like the because we're burning the American flag. And so it was almost like showing our flag in a way, you know what I mean? And so, yeah, that was the importance of putting the Haitian flag in there.
Just one quick thing before we roll into the next one. I think this is actually Bruce's question, but you know, you got Dear Portland Police, but you have a series of Dear blank, blank, blanks in your catalog.
For sure.
Can you talk about what this kind of the series of Dears are about?
Yeah. I think usually when I put Dear, it's probably going to be something controversial. But it's just me expressing myself, and I feel like the reason why I put dear is because it's almost like a letter, and I'm just an echo of what a bunch of people are saying, and I'm just like an ambassador, so I'm just writing a letter. And I remember, you know, Tupac wrote a letter to the president, and I just remember him saying, "Dear Mr. President," and that was a big inspiration behind me doing the, you know, the dear and writing to Dear White Portland, Dear Willamette Week, Dear Portland Police. And it's almost just like, because I feel like people are shocked a lot of the times, and they're thinking, you know, it's something daring to do. And I just wanted to be straightforward and get the point across. And I feel like titling the songs in that way, it does that.
I'm just curious, like, because one of those was Dear Willamette Week. Did you get a response from them?
Oh, yeah, for sure. For sure. There was a music video. The music video was very controversial. It ruffled a lot of feathers. And, you know, the Willamette Week had never written about me previously. And that was almost like why I was doing the song, because they had written about a lot of my peers, a lot of artists that I've mentored, and they had never written about me, but I had sent them a lot of press releases and called them and different things like that. And so, you know, I just felt that they were kind of, you know, putting their nose into my culture and making claims about Portland hip hop when like Willamette Week and Portland hip hop are two different things, you know? So they definitely wrote about it. They put it in the physical paper as well as online, and it was a big thing. It was like a shitstorm in my life for a second. Sometimes it gets stressful, just all of the critics and all the people talking about it. But I'd have to remind myself, you know, that it was something that I wanted to do. It was something that I brought on myself, and it needed to be said. And, you know, great opportunities came from that. Me and Willamette Week, people thought that maybe we had bad blood, but really it was just a back and forth that we were doing, just a dialogue we were having, because Willamette Week has showed love after that. They've done stories on me. And that was just their introduction, I feel like, of just them knowing that I was a force. And I felt like they kind of forced my hand with that one. And it was fun. It was crazy. It was stressful. And definitely let them know who I was.
Sure. Well, yeah, so you want to get into Lit tonight?
Let's do it. Yeah, we should do a little intro. This is Lit Tonight with Swiggle and Raz Simone out of Seattle. So this is the first song on his newest album, Portlandsterdam. So this is Lit Tonight.
Swiggle, swiggle, swiggle. What it do, Raz? Hey.
Freak on the
eight. The freaks come out at night. Timmy rockin' gold like Mr. T. I got my fucking fur coat on. Looking like I'm Willie Dynamite. Got my body looking like graffiti. My queen looking like a Nefertiti. Shroom like Luigi. Fresh like a groom, but I'm peasy. Gold teeth underneath my lip. So I'm cheesing like some dip. OG breathing, so I'm lit. No, I'm twisting in some him. Fur coat season like a pimp. Apes on my feet like a chimp. Fake jewelry on, take that monkey shit off. I floss, nigga, fuck what it costs. Suede on my Pumas, vape, not a hookah. Got the letter L, cooler with the face of Medusa. Nigga, you a loser, your bitch, she a chooser. I wouldn't touch it with a ruler. Portland is popping like pussy for sure. Look at my swag, as sharp as a thorn. Locals only, nigga, where was you born? Nobody ever seen you before.
Excuse me, pardon me. Can I please get by? Please don't blow my
my eye. I just caught a grapevine. Hey, 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 hey. We gon' get lit tonight. 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 We gon' get lit tonight.
Please come out at night. Sleeping on gold, Egyptian king. All that sleep deprivation that a nigga been on got me feeling like I'm sipping lean. Trap nigga, but I'm trapping to a different beat. In the field, no football, different cleats. Little dope bitch, don't try to suck my dick unless you got no gap or some missing teeth. They only fuck on me halfway. No friends with the brother in the back cave. Break a white bitch down in the pack pan. Break a black bitch off like the other pack came. I am too real for one genre. Best believe I mean all my entendres. Keep a couple sticks to turn you to sodas. For all that cheese, them cars at lasagna.
Excuse me, pardon me. Can I please get by? Please don't blow my eye. I just cut a grapevine. Hey, 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 hey. We gon' get lit tonight. 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 We gon' get lit tonight.
All we do is put the city on. That's why we get litty on. All we do is put the city on. That's why we get litty on. All we do is put the city on. That's why we get litty on. All we do is put the city on. That's why we get litty on.
Swiggle.
Yep, I was lit tonight by Swiggle Mandela and Raz Simone. This is Press Play Northwest Live. I saw we got a question in the chat. It was actually about the last one, so I'm gonna just ask you real quick before we get into this this video. But Charles Smith said, "How hard was it to do Dear Portland Police?"
It wasn't hard, honestly, as far as the song, the lyrics to that one. Sometimes it takes me like months to write songs, but the lyrics to Dear Portland Police, every time I write it, it just always just flows. Like, it's not hard to speak on it. It's almost like just freestyling. It just comes to me. I don't even be having to write it. And then I think, the courage to put it out and the courage to just say it, that was probably like the most difficult part, but that wasn't even difficult. It was easy to just step over that line and just decide like, this is what I'm doing and this is how I'm gonna do it. But you know, just thinking about the police and thinking about, you know, the power that they have, and thinking about people who support the police and different organizations that are against that, just that type of song and subject matter. So thinking about that a little bit, you know, people are crazy, man. People are extreme. And, you know, people hear the song sometimes and they get real upset. They get real hateful. So, you know, there's that part. And that's just being brave and crossing the line. So it wasn't really hard, man. I think it was hard. But for what, you know, I endure and what my people endure, it was a simple thing to just jump out there and do it.
Absolutely. Well, appreciate that. And thank you for that question, Charles. On Lit Tonight, though, you know, we got a few different things going on in that video. But, you know, part of that was the show that you did co-headline as part of your series Prominence with Raz Simone. So you've done this a few times now. But can you talk about the background of that show, or not that show rather, but bringing this video together?
Doing Lit Tonight was trying to build, oh yeah, shout out to my guy Egg Bovado tuning in, shout out to Charles for the comment, shout out to my guy Compa, shout out to Crazy MC, everybody tuning in. But that was really trying to just build that bridge and strengthen the connection between Portland and Seattle. Because I just like what Seattle is doing, and I feel like Seattle is honestly ahead of Portland in a lot of ways when it comes to music. I feel that they've had a lot of success, and when those artists from Seattle found success, they showed where that success was. You know, they gave a blueprint, they gave a map, they gave directions, and they helped other artists, you know, come up behind them. And I really always admired that about Seattle. I just think that Seattle, the people, the city, they have a fan culture. Just the way that they root for the Seahawks, you know, they're painting their cars that color, they're painting their faces. And they've had, you know, Jimi Hendrix was in Seattle. When Bruce Lee came to America, he went to Seattle. They have Nirvana and Blue Scholars and Macklemore and Sir Mix-a-Lot. And they've kind of had that environment to be around celebrity and know kind of how to treat those people. And I wanted to just bring that to Portland and go experience that for myself too, even just the Black community in Seattle, the African community in Seattle, the Asian community, Filipino community up there is very different. And so just wanted to, because I feel like the Northwest is stronger than just Portland or just Seattle. Not to say that, you know, those places are great places and have strength on their own, but I just feel that, you know, those two major cities, Portland and Seattle and everywhere in between, you know, Vancouver and Tri-Cities and Olympia and Spokane, everywhere, that we're really strong as a region, and we're going to have a moment as a region. And I just wanted to be ahead of that. And that's why I wanted to bring Raz Simone and, you know, just bringing those type of people to the city. He's doing a lot business-wise. He did a lot for the movement as far as protests and just for his city and for the culture in general. And so, you know, I wanted to bring that type of expertise, that type of music, that type of culture, that type of wealth around my city, and show Raz and show Seattle that, you know, what we can do as artists. As far as, you know, we did a sold out show. You know, we did a great music video. My boy DJ LaFreak did the beat, and just showing Raz what we can do, and bringing him into our environment. Because, you know, I went to Seattle and kicked it with Raz at his headquarters and met all types of different connections, and, you know, was at his party in his environment, and went to the studio in Seattle and recorded, and just wanted to really bring those things together and show people another level of entertainment, of, you know, because that doesn't happen a lot that a Portland artist is bringing a Seattle artist down to Portland, or even a Seattle artist bringing a Portland artist up there. And, you know, even just as Black people and brown people, we there's not a lot of us in the Northwest, you know, especially in Oregon. So, you know, that's family, that's our allies, that's our team. So, you know, I just really wanted to show people that it's bigger than one city.
Yeah, and with that, you know, that show prominence, we were talking about it off screen a little bit. Bruce in particular, just like the amount of running around you were doing, like you would go and perform, do a couple songs, and then you'd be running the merch table, then you'd be out there talking to people out in the crowd, and then you'd go back to the merch room. You're doing a lot of things you know, as part of that operation, but the prominence series that this night was a part of, I know that was like that's part of your general ethos too with this, is like just highlighting what Portland has to offer, right?
For sure. And just trying to give set the bar and give people something to work to and show people that there's a level, you know, and give artists something to aspire to, because as much as people want to say, you know, first before I even say what I'm going to say, I want to say, you know, everybody's created equal. We're all, no matter what color your skin is, no matter where you come from, how you identify with yourself, everybody's family, we're all, you know, equal. But when it comes to creating art and making music and being in a practice and in an art form, there's always levels. And with prominence, I wanted it to be one of the highest levels of you know, entertainment here in the city. And, you know, that a young artist could look and think like, yo, one day I may perform at prominence. I may have that opportunity to share the stage with these artists and at this level. And so that was kind of the idea behind prominence. And that's why I wanted to book, you know, Mike Capes and Cool Nuts and Sour D's and Mighty and Raz Simone, and artists who I feel are on the come up and may not have the notoriety yet, but deserve to share the stage with us and have that quality of music. So that was the whole idea behind prominence.
Yeah, just, you know, for the people who weren't, like, I hadn't been to the previous installments, but I was at, you know, the last one earlier this year. And like, for people who weren't there, like, you had to have, like, I swear, like 30 artists just on the bill performing that night. And like, you know, Donovan was saying, like, I can't imagine what it was like, you know, behind the scenes, plus we're on the merch table. But like, for someone just in the crowd, and like I said, a sold out spot that overflowed, you know, like, it was just amazing to watch. But I also think it's like, you know, Don was talking earlier about sort of like the entrepreneurial like spirit you have to, you know, just how you move. And like, for me, it was just interesting watching, because of like, you know, someone who's kind of like more watch you from like afar, as just, you know, someone who used to cover the scene, still follows a bunch of stuff. And like, we're talking again off screen about, you know, seeing you just like passing out flyers at a, you know, Intizar Abioto's installation in Salem. You know, so for those who don't know, amazing photographer, this great artist, you check her out. But, you know, I remember Donovan telling me something about like doing shows out in like LeGrand and stuff like that. And it's just like a real, you know, it's like, you know, all the cliches about like hitting the pavement, but like, you know, it's real like that. So you just talk about, you know, I guess just like, as far as like, you know, movement building and like how that kind of like fits into your work and how you move.
Yeah. I think that early in my career, I kind of started to realize like how directly connected to me the amount of fans and the amount of support I'm gonna get is. And I think a lot of artists, they kind of, they're very hopeful, they're very optimistic, which is not a bad thing, but, you know, they feel like if they put their video out to the world on the world wide web, on, you know, YouTube and Facebook and these places, that somebody's gonna see it, maybe even someone that they don't know. I'm always surprised when people know me that I don't know, and it happens all the time. And maybe I should be less surprised now. I think maybe I am a little less surprised, but I'm always surprised because I like to know exactly where my fans are coming from, where they are. I like to be for sure about it. Like how, you know, if you go, I have a song called Portland Parks. It's one of my biggest songs on YouTube. If you go read the comments on Portland Parks, it's just a bunch of people saying, yo, I met you at, I was your bud tender. You handed me a flyer. Yo, I was just walking down the street and you handed me a flyer. My mom asked you for directions and you gave her a flyer. And that comes from me. I got to work like no one is listening to my music. That's how I be feeling sometimes. And I know that someone is listening to it somewhere, but you know, that was the original thought that took me to that place of like, I need to go hand out 500 flyers today. I need to get 2,500 flyers and make sure that they all go to a person and not just sit in a coffee shop or be set on the counter at a dispensary. I have to hand every single one of these out. I need to put up these posters on this street. And you know, I never thought that someone, the amount of plays I get, 10,000 or 20,000, and like we're trying to shoot to get 50,000, we're trying to shoot to get 100,000. When you get 10,000 plays for real, it starts to get to the point where it's snowballing and you can't keep track of everything, but you know that it came from 300 people that you knew showing it to all these people. So I may not know where every single play at all 10,000 came from, but I know that it's the seed it came from, those 300 people that I may know directly, or maybe I knew 200 of them and then 100 of them I kind of knew or didn't, you know what I'm saying? So I kind of always just thought, if I'm not in LaGrande, no one in LaGrande is going to hear my music. If I'm not in California, I can't expect anyone in California to be listening to my music. If I'm not in New York, if I don't go to Detroit, you know, and or if I don't find a way to do this with somebody from Florida, jump on the Zoom with someone in Africa, I don't expect, you know, even when I go look on my Spotify stats and I see there's 50 listeners in Germany, I'm curious about that. Like, are there really, or how do you know, like, who are these 50 people? Like, how can I figure that out? So it just comes from almost like a hopeless, like a hopeless place of just like, no one is going to be pushing my music. There's artists who are on the radio. When you're on the radio, you're getting like thousands of plays guaranteed. And there's so many people who have radios in their car and they have the number at the radio station. They can tell you at 12 o'clock, there's going to be 100,000 people on it. So it's like, when you don't have that, you're not on MTV, you're not on these Spotify playlists, these motors, these huge engines. I don't even expect people to hear my music. Like, I don't. And so I'm always surprised when there's, you know, there's thousands of people who listen to my music, hundreds, and they know who I am. And a lot of times they'll surprise me, you know, be out in public, it's just a stranger. I'll be in the airport coming, you know, back to Portland or something. I'm in a different state. Someone may recognize me. So it's crazy, but that grind, and it comes from, you know, being inspired by Nipsey Hussle, being inspired by Tech N9ne, being inspired by Mac Dre, and artists who talked, you know, Master P, artists who talked about, you have to go there. You have to put the groundwork in. You have to have a team. You have to hit the streets, or, you know, you're throwing darts in the dark, you know what I'm saying? And so that's really where that comes from, of just me always trying to guarantee that I'm communicating with my audience and I'm growing my audience, because otherwise I feel like it's just standing still. And if it's standing still, I feel like it's moving backwards.
Yeah. Well, one, thanks for that. I know a lot of people would pay like $50 for a seminar for, you know, what you just shared there. So, you know, and it's funny you mentioned Master P, because like I recently watched, you know, the No Limit documentary on BET, and it kind of had me thinking about this conversation, just like all your different ventures and whatnot. So can you talk a little bit about that? I know Donovan mentioned La Familia earlier, you know, the Swiggle Burger, but can you just talk about some of the different, you know, things outside of the music that you have going on?
Definitely. So at the top, I want to say 2019, and I should know this better, but I just have so much to remember all the time. We opened up a store in North Portland, a co-op, and we allowed different artists, different designers to come sell their stuff in the store, as well as my clothing line. So then there's the clothing line as well. We do men's clothes, women's clothes, kids' clothes, unisex. We're doing all types of designs. My wife helps me a lot with the ladies' designs, and we're doing track suits and shirts, hats, sweatsuits, and just everything with the merch. Then we have La Familia Gang Music, which is just the company, the brand, the collective. And I have artists that are you know, basically signed to the company. And, you know, I stay booking them, giving them advice, doing songs with them, making sure that they know what they should be doing, or, you know, getting them the right connections if they need to go to the studio, if they need a cameraman, if they need a venue, or if they just need advice of any kind, just make sure that they have that. And then, of course, yeah, I'm always collaborating with local businesses. So shout out to Pastas. We worked out. We sat down and talked about how we could incorporate my brand and mix it with food. And we released a Swiggle Burger. And, you know, that was a way for me to give back, because I gave away a lot of free burgers just to fans and supporters and people with children, and made sure that we just gave back, because right now, you know, people are showing so much support. We're getting we're in a good position. We're seeing a lot of success, and I just want to give back. Doing the acting as well, just on a whole nother note of just trying to have multiple streams of income and practice different forms of art. So just doing a lot of background work, and just being on that entertainment scene. My bad. My brother keeps on trying to call me. He's messing up the connection. I'm doing an interview. Let me call you back. Yeah, my bad. It's forever something. That's my brother, though, probably trying to handle some business. Doing the acting, you know, I'm writing a movie now. So, you know, we always do casting and we do photo shoots. We give models opportunities. We do a whole bunch. I do commercials. I got a sponsorship from a company called Real Nice Winemakers. I got a sponsorship from a CBD company called Brothers Apostle. We do a lot outside of music. Music is definitely one of the streams. Mentoring, going into schools, talking to kids. I know there's something I'm forgetting, but that's a lot of it.
All right, Donovan, are you about to ask something?
I've got a chance to build with Swiggle more through just doing business with them at the co-op. There's some ignorant reflections in there. And the funny thing is, even with the Willamette Week thing, I remember when he was first opening the store, he had taken a picture of me inside of there. And that picture caused somebody to reach out to me. And that person was like, I want to do a story on this shop that you're talking about. And Max. And then after, I was like, what outlet are you trying to do it for? He was like, anywhere. I was like, you should do it for the Willamette Week, man.
What?
Just full circle. He did that. And then, the story came out. And then also, I mean, now he's working as Swiggle's manager. So, I mean, that was just like a crazy full circle kind of thing that happened with the co-op that I thought was tight, you know?
For sure.
Yeah.
That a lot of positive came from that, man. A lot was built just from that conversation, that from just those happenings that you just talked about. Like, so much has grown from that. So it was definitely a good time, man. And getting the Willamette Week to write about the story was just made it all full circle.
Yep. And him being willing to make that pitch, that was dope. Shout out to Max. I seen he was watching on here too.
Max, shout out to Max, man. Big Max D, man. Max Denon.
Yeah.
That's the homie, man. That's my brother for life. We built a lot. We did a lot.
Yeah. Molly, did you have anything? I know you've been running back in.
Yeah, I've been kind of quiet in the background here, but I do have a question. Just, your brand is La Familia. You do mentoring. You're a lot of the things that you've been talking about really center relationship. And I know that this is a time where people are feeling maybe more isolated and just far away, not as connected as maybe they want to be. I know there's a lot of people that want, like you, want to be out in the streets, want to be doing more and can't because of their own health concerns, or maybe they have kids that are, you know, have sensitive health concerns. You know, how do you stay connected, build connections, build these relationships now? I know you're not going out on tour right now. I know you're not, hosting packed venues. What does that look like now in your business, and what kind of advice do you have for, I don't know, some of your fans?
One of the biggest ways that I was able to connect with people were the protests that I was able to go out and do. But aside from that, Zoom, I've been meeting a lot of new podcasters, a lot of new people who are doing stuff like this. And so in social media, man, it's a gift and a curse, you know. I'm looking for artists. For example, like in Seattle, I may just start digging into the Seattle scene and wind up finding some dope artists that I don't know about. And I just end up reaching out to them and just, you know, telling them that I'm digging what they're doing and seeing if we can make a connection, if we can build in any way and have a conversation. But man, it's really hard, honestly. I'm FaceTiming a lot, calling a lot of people, just trying to stay connected, because I do feel really pretty disconnected without concerts, without being able to open up the store and things like that. So, you know, I've really just been leaning on my art and, you know, these different platforms. And it's, you know, it's a bittersweet thing, because we don't own these platforms, but you know, we own our brands and we own our entities. So I just been putting out art and just seeing how far it can go, and honestly just getting ready. I'm working on a movie right now, and so eventually I'm going to start the casting process. We're going to start just getting the whole team together of anybody who wants to help in any way. So, man, it's a trip, but it's a lot of the internet. It's a lot of just personal, you know, passing contacts. If my brother needs something and I know somebody, you know what I'm saying? Just, yo, can I give your number to him and things like that. So it's a hard time to connect, but it's a technology, man. It's a gift and a curse. It's really been how I've been staying connected as much as I can. And like these a lot of these Zoom podcast interviews, and I really dig it, because you know, I'm not trying to link up for every single interview and have to always go somewhere. And even in my life, if it wasn't like a pandemic going on, I feel like I've learned a lot of different strategies and a lot of different things that could be useful for even when, you know, the world is back to normal, you know what I'm saying? And I just did a podcast with someone I met on Instagram who's in Africa, and we did Zoom, and we were able to have that conversation. Someone from Kenya, and you know, I just did one with someone from New York and someone from San Francisco. So it's been dope to connect with people, and it's kind of been forced because of the situation, but I have been able to connect with people that I probably wouldn't have if, you know, the situation, if the world wasn't in the predicament that it's in.
Got it. Well, yeah, we appreciate you being here, you know, spending time with us and breaking down the art and everything. Yeah, just wanted to have you plug anything that people should be aware of, anything you want people to know about.
I'm working on an album. I had originally titled it The Movement, and because I am in charge of my own career and pretty much do whatever I want, I'm changing the name to The Motion Picture. It's going to be called Swiggle Mandela, The Motion Picture. Due to, you know, COVID-19 and the wildfires, the release date, I don't even know when it's going to come out yet. I wanted it to be on the same day as Portlandsterdam, which is October 25th, my birthday. But the anniversary for Portlandsterdam is coming up. Probably do something special for that, October 25th. The movie is coming out. I'm not sure what it's called yet. I know that the album is called The Motion Picture, so I'm trying to figure out what's called the movie now. but I'm working on a movie. It's going to be like a musical. So it's going to be like 6 music videos connected. And then there'll be like scenes probably in between that, you know, connect the videos. So, I probably won't have like a music video for a while, because I really want to do something that is more time consuming and takes more of, you know, takes me longer to create. Cause, for example, a video like Dear Portland Police, we really wanted to get that out quickly, because we wanted it to be to match the cultural climate that's happening right now. We didn't want to put it out when everything calmed down and when, you know, laws have already changed, or, you know, so we wanted to help the fight with that. And so we filmed that in 2 days. It didn't, you know what I'm saying? And then we put it out within a couple of weeks. And so I want to film something that takes longer than 2 days. I want to really, you know, take my time, and it's probably going to take some weeks, you know, 7 to 8 weeks to really film and convey what I want to do. So the movie, I think that should be what people are most excited about. And then just checking out everything that's already out. You know, I've done so many features that people probably haven't heard all of them. I work with so many local artists and so many artists from the city. I just want to show love and from around here, like outside of the city, just in the Northwest period. So just look out for my features, because I'm doing a lot of features. And you know, if you haven't seen Dear Portland Police, if you haven't seen 40 Acres in a New Car, Goddess, Lit Tonight, just go check me out, man. YouTube, Spotify, Tidal, Amazon, Google Play, Instagram, Twitter, everywhere. Put my name in that search bar, Swiggle Mandela, Swiggle Mandela like Nelson. Yeah, man, check me out, stream my music. And I'm only as big as I am because of my fans, my friends, my family, my supporters. So if you know, those people who wanted to see me perform in Hollywood, they got me there. Those people who wanted to see me in New York, they got me there. Those people who wanted to see me, you know, do a song with Raz Simone or be on TV, y'all got me there. So I really appreciate that from the core of my being. And if you want to see any of your people, any of these people on this screen today, any of the people in your life, you want to see them go further in entertainment or go anywhere, it's going to depend on, you know, the supporters, honestly. And we do our part just by making great art and being humble people. But, you know, if you want to see me go further, share my music, keep showing it to people, keep that conversation going. Thank y'all for supporting me and you know, diving into my art and paying attention and knowing the how profound it is, because sometimes people can miss it. You know, we had one of the most relevant songs to come out in Portland in 2020, with it being, you know, the soundtrack to the protests and people playing it hundreds and hundreds of times and thousands of times on the front line and playing it for the police and play, you know, and some people missed it still. So it's important that we tell these stories, that we create these platforms to amplify, you know, my voice, y'all voice. And yeah, man, if y'all want to see me go further, we going, you know, all that fly shit, BET, Revolt TV, all of that. Just keep pushing me, keep pushing the music, telling people and sharing the message of Swiggle Mandela, of La Familia, you know, of that real, you know, Albina District shit, that real Northwest shit. So I really appreciate y'all. And yeah, man, look me up, Swiggle Mandela, put my name in that search bar.
Yeah, man. Well, we just want to thank you again for, you know, taking the time to speak with us, taking the time to, you know, dig into your music videos, talk about just the movement overall. So, yeah, it's been another episode of Press Play Northwest Live. Again, we want to thank Swiggle Mandela for taking the time with us. And we don't have announcements right now. We got some stuff under construction, but, you know, you can check out archives on YouTube at Press Play NW. And yeah, Dom, you want to sign us off?
Yeah,
the official.
This has been Press Play Northwest, and be sure to tune in to our next episode, because honestly, where else are you gonna go?
Where?